The U.S. Supreme Court has rejected a challenge by Republican Pennsylvania lawmakers to an effort to make it easier to register to vote. And the largest water utility in the country that serves a big portion of Pennsylvania is targeted by a cyber attack. Welcome to The Morning Agenda, WITF's daily news podcast, where the only agenda is you. A good morning to you. It is Tuesday, October 8th, and this is being recorded at 5:30 a.m. I'm your host, Tim Lambert, as we take this daily trip around the region's top stories together. The nation's highest court has turned away a challenge from Republican state lawmakers in Pennsylvania to a Biden administration executive order that's intended to boost voter registration. The justices did not comment in rejecting an appeal from the Republicans, who claimed the order is an unconstitutional attempt to interfere in the November election. Lower courts had dismissed the lawsuit. The justices separately rejected two appeals from Colorado and Pennsylvania stemming from baseless claims made by Republicans that voting machines and software of Dominion voting systems were responsible for Donald Trump's defeat in the 2020 presidential election. And we'll note the existence of reports, including one by a prominent group of Republicans who established no fraud in the 2020 election, as well as the recent revelation that Trump's campaign paid researchers to prove his false claim of fraud, and the report was never released because the researchers determined there was no fraud. A bill recently passed by the state Senate would provide funding to create safe exchange zones for custody exchanges and online marketplace sales. They'll have video surveillance and be near a law enforcement office or in a public area. Sydney Roach is with our friends at WPSU in State College and takes a look at how it's working in some communities where they're already in place.
Clearfield Borough Council members established a safe exchange zone last year in the parking lot of the former police building. Mason Strauss, Clearfield's mayor, says the parking lot was already well lit and has security cameras. All they had to do was install a safe exchange zone sign.
The sign says reserved for child custody, e-commerce, and private property exchanges. And it says that it's under 24-hour surveillance. And if police response is needed, please call 911 and then it has the non-emergency number as well.
Strauss says he's seen many people in the community using the zone. Senator Wayne Langerhulk is the prime sponsor of the measure to create grant funding for municipalities to establish safe exchange zones. He says they can prevent tragedies like the one in Johnstown 3 years ago, where a woman was killed during a Facebook marketplace exchange. The proposal now awaits action in the state house. It's been a decade since one party controlled the governor's mansion and the state legislature. From our partners at WESA in Pittsburgh, Tom Reese reports the November elections could pave the way for new state laws or changes to the state's constitution itself.
Republicans controlled the House and the Senate under Governor Tom Corbett. With Democrat Josh Shapiro in the governor's mansion, they won't have that kind of power next year. But if either party wins control of both the Senate and the House, they can try to amend the state constitution. Ultimately, voters get to decide on any changes to the Constitution, but putting it before them requires legislative approval twice. Jerry Dickinson is a constitutional law professor at the University of Pittsburgh. He says amending the Constitution isn't easy.
In Pennsylvania, first it has to be amended through the legislative process, and you've got to do it in essentially two consecutive sessions.
Now, measures likely to die this legislative session include a voter ID requirement and a measure to limit protections for abortion. And the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention is working to improve the way it reports firearm injuries. Sandra Jones is with our partners at WHYY in Philadelphia, and she takes a look at how the move comes after President Joe Biden signed an executive order directing federal agencies to do more to reduce gun violence and strengthen prevention programs.
For Maxanne Gooden, losing a son to gun violence hurts, even 7 years later.
I still think about that because it was such a shock to my system.
Her son, Jackson Patton, was shot and killed while visiting his sister in Harrisburg on Thanksgiving Day in 2017. Gooden says her son could not wait to spend time with family and celebrate his college acceptances. She never imagined it would be the last time she would see Patton alive.
And the next time I saw my son was in a casket coming home. It was really hard.
The CDC will now use data from vital statistics and local emergency rooms to improve its public reporting. It's part of a move to help reduce gun violence and save lives. All right, so I went through about a dozen news sites across central Pennsylvania that I check each and every morning when I get in the office, and I came across a couple of stories to pass along to you. The largest regulated water and wastewater utility company in the U.S. that serves more than 2.3 million Pennsylvanians says it was the victim of a cyber attack. It prompted American Water to pause billing to customers. The New Jersey-based firm says it became aware of the unauthorized activity last Thursday and immediately took proactive steps, including shutting down certain systems. The company does not believe its facilities or operations were impacted by the attack and says staffers were working around the clock to investigate the nature and scope of it. Pennsylvania American Water serves more than 400 communities in 37 counties. And a York County school district has reversed course and boarded up window openings it recently installed that allow people in a middle school hallway to peer into two gender-neutral designated bathrooms. Southwestern School District Superintendent Jay Burkhart says the two windows were installed in recent weeks following an August vote by the district's conservative majority school board. The board president says the move was designed to monitor and prevent misbehavior. Such openings were not installed in any of the school's non-gender-neutral bathrooms. Burkhart says they were covered by plywood last Thursday on the advice of lawyers from the Harrisburg-based Independence Law Center, a conservative legal group the board consulted before ordering the windows installed. And now on to a bit of a deep dive. The presidential election in Pennsylvania could be decided by a razor-thin margin, so political canvassers are descending on the Commonwealth to try and pick up any votes they can. From our friends at WHYY in Philadelphia, Sophia Schmidt shadows one group hoping to mobilize potential voters in Philadelphia who care about the environment.
A small group of volunteers gather at a park in Philly's Manayunk neighborhood. They wear stickers on their shirts with green check marks that read, Environmental Voter Project Volunteer. They're here to knock on doors and get people to the polls in November.
So we'll do our quick little training so that everybody can get started.
Volunteer Hillary Nyberg lives in South Philadelphia. She explains the group is targeting people who are likely to care about climate and the environment, but who rarely or never vote.
So today we're going to be talking to registered voters who are unlikely to vote in this upcoming election about getting out to vote.
The Environmental Voter Project is a national nonprofit with one goal, build a base of environmental super voters. Founder Nathaniel Stinnett wants to mobilize a climate voter bloc that can't be ignored.
Politicians will only lead on climate when voters force them to. And so we've got two ways to make that happen. One is to try to convince a whole lot of voters to care more about climate change. And that's hard and messy and expensive. The other way is to get a whole bunch of people who already care about climate to start voting. And that's a little bit easier.
Stinnett says the group starts with surveys to find people who already count climate as their top political priority. Then they use demographics, where people live, and factors like whether they've recently bought an electric vehicle to find other people who could become environmental super voters. Philadelphia is one of four cities where the group is canvassing this fall. The group is nonpartisan, so they don't talk about candidates or parties. And surprisingly, they don't talk about climate change. The strategy is just to get people to commit to show up to the polls.
Thank you so much. I think we're ready to throw.
I trail Nyberg around the hilly neighborhood of row homes. She follows the map of target households on her phone. She opens gates and storm doors. She knocks. She rings doorbells. She knocks some more. And most people don't answer.
Try the next one. All right. I'm looking for Molly and Caitlin here.
At each house, Nyberg writes the target person's name on a door hanger. It includes the date of November's election and a little peer pressure. It reads, who you vote for is secret, but whether you vote is public record. After knocking on doors for over an hour, Nyberg finally gets a chance to put the strategy into action.
Hi, my name is Hillary. Is Brian available?
The person doesn't want to talk, but Nyberg squeezes in her line.
Can we count on you to be a good voter this year and vote in the election? Okay, fantastic. Thank you so much.
Walking away from the house, Hillary counts the interaction as a win.
I spoke to the person who was on my list, which is awesome, and he said that, he's going to vote in the fall, which is wonderful.
Stinnett sees even this brief interaction as a success, too.
you just got them to say that they're going to vote.
Yes.
And that's like a trap closing on them, because now one of our other volunteers can call them right before the election and say, hey, remember on September 29th you said that you were going to vote? Well, the election's coming up on Tuesday and we know you want to keep your promise.
The group's strategy of talking about voting instead of climate may seem counterintuitive, but Chris Borick, a public opinion researcher at Muhlenberg College, says it's smart.
We know who these people are. We know that climate matters for them. But would climate itself unlock the door? It hasn't in the past, right? They cared about this issue. The cares were there. The saliency was there. Yet it didn't translate into behavior.
In Pennsylvania, the group hopes their efforts will be key to unlocking a few thousand additional environmental votes this fall. It would be a small but potentially important sliver in a state where the past two presidential elections were decided by just tens of thousands of votes. During the canvassing event in Manayunk, the group of volunteers together talked to a few dozen people. To Nyberg, the volunteer, this feels like she's made a difference.
I want to be a parent and thinking about like the future of my future children, the children of my friends and families, of the kids in my neighborhood. I want to know that that I've done what I can in my lifetime.
I'm Sophia Schmidt.
Now, as a reminder, we're available anywhere you find your favorite podcast and on WITF's YouTube channel, which you can subscribe to. We are also on the NPR app. I hope you check out our Spotify playlist. It's called The Morning Agenda Song of the Day, October 2024, and I add one song to it every morning. And today I added a tune from the Stone Temple Pilots, Interstate Love Song, an absolute 90s classic. That's going to do it now for The Morning Agenda. It's a daily news podcast from WITF, where the only agenda is you. I'm your host, Tim Lambert. Thank you so much for listening today. Your company is always appreciated. Be well, enjoy the rest of the day, and we'll talk again tomorrow.